sign Senator Ibrahim Abdullahi Dambaba. Distinguished colleagues, the Senator Chief Whip. Let's finish with the one before me, before I take yours. So there's no way you can miss this. You don't need to hurry. The gate will not be closed now. The door will remain open. Don't worry, don't worry. Let's calm down. just hold on. Chief Whip, Minority Whip, just calm down. This door is not going to be shut. I just want to, on behalf of all of us, congratulate the Distinguished Senator Ibrahim Dambaba for taking the right decision at the right time. And we are happy to have you. And I want to assure you that you are in the right place. It's time for all Nigerians to come together to work for the development of our country. Partisanship we may from time to time express, but statesmanship is extremely necessary for all of us in leadership positions. And I want to also assure you that you won't miss anything. You won't miss anything by moving from that political party. Thank God the wreckage did not hurt you. At least you are able to come out, and you can see how your immediate boss, the former immediate boss, the Minority Whip, is struggling to also hand in his letter. But I would rather, instead of collecting your letter today, I would rather allow you to have a statement to make. At least something that you will leave them with as a food for thought. So, once again, you are welcome and congratulations. The Minority Whip, point of order.
Mr. President, distinguished colleagues, mine is a personal explanation. And Mr. President, what Dambaba has said and alluded to.
I want you to cite the order. Personal explanation. But I want you to read all of it. Read all of it.
President. Mr. President. I just want 42, sir.
No, I want, yes, granted, but read all of it. Yeah, read all of it. No, 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 no. You know, Minority Whip, you have been given the opportunity to come under order 42 as you requested. But I'm asking you to read what Order 42 says to the hearing of all of us.
Yes, Mr. President, by the indulgence of the Senate and the leave of the President of the Senate, a senator may make a personal explanation, although there be no question before the Senate, but no controversial matter may be brought before nor may debate arise upon the explanation. The terms of the proposed statement shall be submitted
in advance
in detail to the President of the Senate when he leaves to make it his source. Mr. President, distinguished colleagues, is the exigency of the time that has been.
No. Let me emphasize. You will still speak. I'm more particularly concerned with that last sentence. The terms of the proposed statement shall be submitted in detail to the President of the Senate when he is leave to make it his sort. You know, I don't want you to, you will not suffer any injury here. You haven't, but I will still allow you to make your remarks on this. So go ahead.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. Mr. President, my immediate former deputy minority whip has alluded to the fact that there are crises in the northwest region of the PDP, and has also said that there is a crisis in his state. I want to state that there are no crises in the PDP in the northwest. So these might be personal, but otherwise there are no. I just want the public and everybody in Nigeria to know that there is no crisis in the PDP in the northwest.
Okay, so that is what, that's all you have to say.
Yes, I want the Senate to take note of that.
Are you from the northwest?
And
no, it's all right. It's all right. I think you have that privilege of saying what you've said, but at the risk of joining you in this controversy, if someone from who represents a senatorial district in Sokoto State, a senator, a distinguished senator, stands up here in this chamber and says in his place, this is the situation, an FCT senator will say, no, it doesn't exist. I think there is a question to be asked whether it is you that know better or him that represents that senatorial district. But by the way, you should expect more. You should expect more of this. Point of order, the distinguished Senator Uche Lilian Ekwenife Iyom.
Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. President, my distinguished colleagues, my name is Senator Uche Lilian Ekwenife Iyom, Ifekoledo of Upo. I come from Anambra State. I represent Anambra Central. Mr. President, I'm coming under point of order, constitutional order, section 68 of 1999 constitution as altered. Mr. President, let me take you to subsection G. Based on the fact that our deputy minority whip is intending to defect to APC side, that side, eh?
Distinguish. No, you just listen, please. Just listen. You will still talk, but I want to correct an impression. He is not intending. He has moved. I read his letter. So the earlier you understand this and accept it, the better for you. Go ahead.
Mr. President, now that he has decided to move to the other side, he has to vacate his seat immediately based on the constitutional provision on the fact that once you move from the party that brought you into an office, you have to relinquish that particular position. Mr. President, let me take you to section 68, subsection G. Being a person whose election to the House was sponsored by a political party, he becomes a member of another political party before the expiration of the period for which that House was elected, provided that this membership of that latter political party is not as a result of a division in the political party of which he was previously a member of a merger or two or more political parties or factions by one of which he was previously sponsored. he has to vacate the office. Yeah. Mr. President, he
came to the Senate. Okay. Allow me rule. You are not be recorded, please. Just allow me rule. You see, no, you are finished. No. At this point is, excuse me, please. At this point is my judgment that you have finished your presentation. And no, I judge it that you are finished. No, I'm not allowing you to go any further. I have to rule. I'm supposed to rule. You raise a point of order. It's not for you to rule. No. Can you please sit down? Sir, I'm not giving you any protection here. Just listen. The Sungu Senator Uche Lilian Ekunife. Thank you very much for your constitutional point of order. And it's an opportunity for me to rule. But before I rule, I want to advise you that some of these things you have said should not be recorded. My fear is one day you will stand up in that place and say you want to move to this side. And all those things you have said. Yes. But all these things you have said may come back to haunt. So that's my advice. You don't have to take that advice. On the issue of 66G or 66 whatever, 68G, you see, we are at liberty as elected representatives of the people. When our parties are torn into pieces, when there are factions, when they are in such irredeemable and destructive crises like the PDPs, we are free to leave, to take our leave. And especially Senator Dambaba, to his credit, worked so hard to help stabilize PDP, take away PDP from the crisis, but it is irredeemable. And therefore, allow me rule. I rule you out of order completely. Thank you. Minority whip. You know, my advice, only two of you are seated on this side. You want to make up for this number by making noise. I will advise that we listen, please, to others. So I have another letter to read. Thank you. Another letter. This one is all for someone the camping. Letter from the Sungu Senator Ibukule Amosun, CONFCA. Our dear Senate President, notification and invitation to the formal declaration to contest for the office of President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria under the All Progressives Congress, APC. I bring warm greetings from my family, my constituents, the entire people of Ogun State, and my support groups across Nigeria. It is with the greatest respect that I write to notify you and my distinguished colleagues of my intention to contest for the office of President of our dear country, the Federal Republic of Nigeria, and to respectfully invite you and my distinguished colleagues to the formal declaration ceremony. I have been blessed by God to serve as Senator of the Federal Republic of Nigeria between 2003 and 2007, and as a two-term Governor of Ogun State between 2011 and 2019. I've also had the privilege to be elected a second time to the Senate of the Federal Republic of Nigeria in 2019, where I currently serve the good people of Ogun Central Senatorial District. My varied experience in private and public life has imbued me with the requisite insights, experiences, and network of relationships adequate to provide a leadership that will galvanize our dear country to achieve her manifest destiny as leader in Africa and of the black race. I will be honored with your esteemed presence and that of my distinguished colleagues at the declaration event, which is scheduled as follows. Date, Thursday, 5th May 2022. Time, 11 a.m. Venue, Sheikh Musa Yar'Adua Center, CBD, Abuja FCT. I seek the prayers of all of you for a successful declaration ceremony, victory at the party primaries, and the 2023 presidential election by the grace of God. Please accept the assurance of my highest regard. Yours sincerely, Senator Ibikule Amosu, CON, FCA, Ogun Central Senatorial District, Chairman, Senate Committee on Capital Markets. Congratulations, my brother. Petitions? Any petitions? Leader of the Senate. Point of order, the single senator, not just Anayo Okorocha.
Mr. President, I rise to speak on Order 42, personal explanation. By the indulgence of the Senate and the leave of the President of the Senate, a senator may make a personal explanation, although there be no question before the Senate. But no controversial matter may be brought forward, nor may debate arise upon the explanation. The terms of the proposed statement shall be submitted in detail to the President of the Senate when his leave to make it is sought. Mr. President, distinguished colleagues, my name is Owele Anayo Orocha Sokrocha. I'm from Imo State and I represent the people of Imo West. I speak with heart full of pains on the ugly incident that led to the loss of 110 lives in Abeze, Imo State, arising from a fire incident that killed 110 souls in a refinery, a local refinery business. Mr. President of the Senate, Senate President, sir, I said this to formally notify you and my colleagues that many families are in pains in Imo State, and Imo State has been thrown into a money mood because of this ugly incident. Many may argue, as they have said, that it was a business of bunkering. But Mr. President, life is involved. It is for this reason that I want to appeal to my colleagues to see reason, to show sympathy, especially to these families, and most of them who are breadwinners to their family. It's also a clarion call on the federal government of Nigeria to take a second look about artisan modular refinery. If young men and women have found a local technology in refining products, they should be so encouraged by making this part of our laws. And instead of hiding and doing it illegally, they can be empowered to do it legally. For many years now, since the inception of this country, we produce oil that we cannot refine, and we still import petroleum products. The activities of these young men and women is simply an indicator that there's a lacuna, there's a space that must be filled, and that's the space of refining our product ourselves. Mr. Senior President, it will be my pleasure that in this information that you can show your fatherly love and care by requesting the Minister of Humanitarian Services on your own, not as a motion, to see what they can do to help the family so concerned. Mr. President, I so submit. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Disungu Senator Rogers Okorocha, for the information. And even though you didn't ask, but I think we'll observe 1 minute silence in honor of those who lost their lives. But let me also re-echo one or two sentiments you've expressed. As a country blessed with petroleum resources, we must ensure that we refine our crude. It has been a long, tortuous journey so far that we have not been able to do that successfully, even after establishment of about three or four refineries. And of course, we are hopeful that the Dangote refinery, with a capacity of 650,000 liters per day, will be commissioned sometimes before the end of this year. But that is something that we have to work so hard to expand. We cannot, in any true sense and in a practical way, benefit better from our the oil and gas resources we have in Nigeria if we don't add the value or refining it. And of course, we know what it means as of today. Even though oil, the crude, sells for higher, but because we have to import the refined products, the increase in price at the international market does not seem to confer any advantage to our country. So that speaks volumes that we have to refine our products, petroleum products in Nigeria, if we have to enjoy the benefits of having an endowment like that. And for Nigerians who get engaged and involved in this kind of illegal refining activities, I think government would have to take action. It's for government to come to a decision on how we should be able to deal with these illegal activities. On one hand, we may encourage private participation. In fact, that is the best way to go. But illegal refining, again, at the moment, is causing a lot of damage to our country. So it's a very dicey situation, but we have to utilize the ingenuity of our citizens, those who are creative and innovative, but in a very much regulated way, so that we don't experience this kind of disasters. With this, let's observe a minute's silence in honor of those that lost their lives in the accident. Thank you. May the souls of our departed compatriots rest in perfect peace. Amen. Leader of the Senate.
Mr. President, my highly respected and distinguished colleagues, the first business of the day is the presentation of a bill standing in the name of distinguished Senator Uche Lilian Ekunife Iyong on the Federal Medical Center Umuahulu Establishment Bill 2022. Mr. President, you may wish to invite the Clerk of the Senate to read the short title of the bill.
Leader, before I do that, let me try a guess here. Minority whip, this side apparently is so scanty. Is it because screening for the governorship or National Assembly? Okay, it's all right. At least we better explain this to, for the public to understand. So, but I also believe that some of you are consulting with the constituents they want to become.
Mr. President, distinguished colleagues, why this our side and the seats are empty from the PDP side is because the nationwide we're going through screening for National Assembly and the various positions, including the state assemblies and governorship. So everybody is at his constituency carrying out the screening. But for me, because I'm here in the FCT, I'm doing mine, and their number one also was moved to the FCT. So the two of us have gotten permission to stay here till 2 o'clock before we can go back for screening.
Okay, that's very kind of you. Wish you very successful screening. Leader of the Senate. Clerk of the Senate, sorry, leader.
Mr. President, distinguished senators, Federal Medical Center Umuahulu Establishment Bill 2022. Mr. President, distinguished senators, a bill for an act to provide for the establishment of the Institute of Information and Communication Technology, Ogbulumabiri, Bayelsa State, and for other matters connected therewith, 2022. Second reading.
A bill for an act to provide for the establishment of information and communication technology Ogbolomabiri, Bayelsa State, and for other matters connected therewith, 2022, second reading taken, and the bill is referred to the Committee on ICT and Cyber Security for further legislative action to report back within 4 weeks. Leader of the Senate.
So, President, my highly respected and distinguished colleagues, the fourth order of the day is the second reading of the Violence Against Persons Prohibition Act 2015, Repeal and Re-enactment Bill 2022. Distinguished senators will recall that the bill was read the first time in this great chamber on Tuesday, 15 February 2022. Mr. President, you may wish to invite distinguished Senator Issa Jibrin to move the motion for the bill to be read the second time.
Distinguished Senator Issa Jibrin.
Your Excellency, Mr. President, distinguished colleagues, I am Issa Jibrin, representing the very good people of Kogi East. Mr. President, my highly respected colleagues, please permit me to lead debate on this very important bill to seeking to repeal the Violence Against Persons Prohibition Act 2015 and enact an act to eliminate violence in private and public life, prohibit all forms of violence against persons, and to provide maximum protection and effective remedies for victims and punishment of offenders and for related matters. This bill was read for the first time on Tuesday, 1st February 2022. Mr. President, distinguished colleagues, due to the far-reaching nature of this bill, let me crave your indulgence to extensively highlight the background, which I believe will not only provide a proper context for this legislative initiative, but also motivate the National Assembly to accelerate the legislative process in enacting this bill. Background: this act was enacted in 2015 against the backdrop of the rising cases of violence, especially domestic violence against women. The initial bill sought protection for women from male domination violence. In the face of opposition to its obvious gender biased nature, the promoters renamed it, tinkered with some of its provisions, introduced seemingly gender neutral language, and successfully obtained its passage. Its explanatory memorandum states that it prohibits all forms of violence against persons in private and public life and provides protection and remedies for victims and punishment of offenders. Upon close scrutiny of the Act, it becomes obvious that it contains prohibitions that are inimical to the realization of its objectives. Mr. President, distinguished colleagues, going through the provisions of the Act, it is obvious that it is plagued with by substantial and drafting challenges. This underscores the necessity for a holistic reform of the Act to bring the provisions in line with the realities of societal change and drafting standards to effective dispensation of justice. Some of the major areas of concern in the Act are highlighted below. There are several strict liability offences in the Act. These are instances where mental element is not needed. But only the physical element, which is all required to complete the offence. This therefore calls for a review to introduce elements of intention. The punishments of fine and imprisonment in the Act have become infinitesimal to have meaningful deterrent effect. This is particularly so in view of the current economic realities in Nigeria. In Section 1 of the Act, the offense of rape needs particular attention. There is a need to make a distinction between absence of consent and consent obtained by fraud, undue influence, and other unlawful means. The Act contains inadequate provisions for compensation of the victims of violence. The penal focus is on fines and imprisonment, with little on compensation. In addition to the punishment, it is better by way of reparation of, for victims to make adequate provisions relating to compensation. The grievous nature of certain offences in the Act, especially Section 22.1, makes the punishment provided inadequate. In view of the rampant cases of chemical attacks, such as acids and other substances, offenders under this section should not be given an option of fine. Similarly, the term of imprisonment needs an upward review. Section 27 of the Act, which vests jurisdiction in the High Court of the Federal Capital Territory, creates crisis of interpretation. Under the provision, the High Court of the Federal Capital Territory needs to be empowered by an Act of Parliament to exercise jurisdiction. This is certainly not the legislative intent therein. Consequently, the component requiring empowerment by an Act of Parliament is unnecessary. There are instances of derogatory expressions in the Act. An example is mentally retarded, used in Section 28.4. This needs to be replaced with a subtle legislative language. There are many cases of wrong cross-referencing in the Act. The implication is that the operators of the Act run into difficulties when it comes to implementation. This opens a floodgate of litigation, which can be avoided by legislative option. The use of the term shall and may in some sections of the Act do not convey legislative intent. Those terms are used haphazardly without due consideration of their outcomes. For example, in Section 33.1, it is provided that whenever a court issues a protection order, the court shall make an order authorizing the issue of a warrant for the arrest of the respondent in the prescribed form, and B, suspending the execution of such warrant subject to compliance with any provision, condition, obligation, or order imposed under Section 331 of this Act. The implication of the use of shall is a mandatory effect, which could not have been the legislative intent. The word may is more appropriate in this circumstance. In Section 34, a strange commissioner is introduced for the purpose of making an application for variation or setting aside of a protection order. This reduces the provision with confusion, as commissioner does not appear anywhere before and after this section. Besides, commissioner is not defined in the interpretation section. The act makes reference to legislations that are already repealed. An example is section 40, which makes reference to the Companies and Allied Matters Act 1990. The current law is Companies and Allied Matters Act 2020. Conclusion, Mr. President, my highly distinguished colleagues, this act is notable for its innovation towards addressing violence in all ramifications. However, the several challenges and inadequacies inherent in it call for urgent legislation action to reposition the legislation for efficiency. A major innovation in this bill is the creation of victim support fund to cater for victims of violence and further provide for composition, funding, and management of the fund. Mr. President, distinguished colleagues, it is because almost all sections of the Act are affected that the bill seeks to repeal and reenact the legislation to avoid making the legislative proposal clumsy. I therefore call on you to give full support to this bill in order to achieve the laudable objectives of the legislation. I thank you very much, Mr. President.
Distinguished Senator Bima Mohammed Enagi, Niger South.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, my highly respected distinguished colleagues. My name is Senator Bima Mohammed Enagi. I represent the people of Niger South from Niger State. I rise to second that the bill be read the second time. In supporting the second reading of this bill, the reasons are quite obvious. You all know that there is rising cases of violence in this country. In the homes, in schools, in markets, everywhere, there are rising cases of violence in this country. So the law has to be made in such a way to meet up with such violent situations. In this country, there are cases where people through violence become permanently disabled. So we must have adequate provisions to take care of such situations. From what the sponsor of this bill had said, it is very clear that the bill, the existing Act 2015, has drafting problems, has problems of cross-references, and also has problems of inadequate provision for certain types of violence in this country. Therefore, I stand here today to second that this bill be read the second time, and I appeal to everybody to support its reading second time. Thank you.
Those who vote that this bill be now read the second time, say aye. Those against, say nay. Clerk of the Senate.
Mr. President, distinguished senators, a bill for an act to repeal the Violence Against Persons Prohibition Act 2015 and enact the Violence Against Persons Prohibition Bill 2022 to eliminate violence in private and public life, prohibit all forms of violence against persons, and to provide maximum protection and effective remedies for victims and punishment of offenders and for related matters 2022, second reading.
A bill for an act to repeal the Violence Against Persons Prohibition Act 2015 and enact the Violence Against Persons Prohibition Bill 2022 to eliminate violence in private and public life, prohibit all forms of violence against persons, and provide maximum protection and effective remedies for victims and punishment of offenders and for related matters 2022, second reading taken, and the bill is referred to the Senate Committee on Judiciary, Human Rights and Legal Matters for further legislative action to report back within 4 weeks. Leader of the Senate.
Mr. President, my highly respected and distinguished colleagues, the fifth order of the day is the second reading of Federal Universities of Technology Act CAP F23, Laws of the Federation of Nigeria 2004, Amendment Bill 2022. Distinguished senators will recall that the bill was read the first time in this chamber on Wednesday, 2nd March 2022. Mr. President, you may wish to invite distinguished Senator Muhammad Bima Enagi to move the motion for the bill to be read the second time.
Distinguished Senator Bima Muhammad Enagi, Niger South.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, my highly respected distinguished colleagues. My name remains Senator Bima Muhammad Enagi. I represent the people of Niger South from Niger State. I stand to lead the debate on Federal University of Technology Act Amendment Bill 2022, SB 948. Mr. President, please permit me to proceed and lead the debate.
You may proceed.
Mr. President, distinguished colleagues, let me use this singular honor to express my sincere appreciation to the Senate and particularly the President for the permission to lead the debate on Federal Universities of Technology Act Amendment Bill 2022. The bill seeks to strengthen the Federal Universities of Technology in the provision of research services and specialized training in entrepreneurship and management technology. The bill was read the first time on Wednesday, 2nd March 2022. Background. The Federal Universities of Technology have been established by single legislation as far back as 1983. The legislation was consolidated as CAP F23, Laws of the Federation 2004. The objective for the establishment is to give effect to the nation's drive for much-needed self-reliance in science, engineering and technology. There are specialized universities with the primary goal of production technology and application of knowledge and skills towards creating the physical hardware for production, exchange, distribution and consumption. The development of Federal Universities of Technology was the work of an educational team of experts that was set up in 1978 by the federal government of Nigeria as a committee under the National Universities Commission. The committee recommended that there is need to establish Federal Universities of Technology for the following reasons. A, to train people for modern science, scientific and technical education. B, to meet the rate of growth in science student population. C, to produce the manpower skills that will lead the country into economic and social development. D, to establish universities in the north, west, and eastern part of the country to balance the geographical spread of the institution. And E, to assure that the technical training is parallel with the pattern of technological training in the United States of America universities, and that the Federal Universities of Technology should have specialized link with the United States universities. Thus, in 1980, 1981, and 1983, the federal government of Nigeria established the Federal Universities of Technology at Owerri, Akure, and Minna to train the diverse personnel required for the economic, technological, educational, and social development of the country. The university's primary purposes were to produce graduates in science subjects and to serve as national institutions for technological research. The objectives of the Federal Universities of Technology in Nigeria include, but not limited to, the following. One, to develop and offer academic and professional programs leading to the first degrees, postgraduate degrees, research and higher degrees, which emphasize planning, adaptive, technical, maintenance, developmental, and productive skills in the engineering, scientific, and agricultural disciplines. Two, to identify technological problems and needs of the society, and to find solutions to them within the context of overall national development. Three, to provide and promote sound basic scientific training as a foundation for the development of technology and applied sciences in needs of national development. Four, to offer to the general population as a forum of public service the results of training and research, and to foster the practical application of these results. Six, to establish appropriate relationship with other national institutions involved in training, research, and development of technologies. And seven, to undertake any other activities appropriate for a university of technology of the highest standard. Notwithstanding the foregoing laudable objectives, it is baffling to note that the federal universities of technology are facing challenges of inadequate funding. The paucity of funds have compelled most of such universities to operate without strategic scientific technological centers, such as industrial development centers. The Federal Universities of Technology in Nigeria, unlike their counterparts in India and United States, do not enjoy any special grant. The funding model the funding model has a disabling effect on the growth and development of the universities of technology because of the capital-intensive nature of science and technology programs. While the conventional universities offer 40-60% ratio of theory to practical-based curriculums, the federal universities of technology are supposed to offer 60-50% theory and practicals, requiring more capital funding for equipment and consumables. Similarly, the scope and content of their curriculum do not accommodate management technology and entrepreneurship, which are necessarily needed to address high rate of unemployment and over-reliance on white-collar jobs in this country. Against this background, the Federal Universities of Technology Act is proposed for amendment to address the challenge of underfunding and limited scope of curriculum to strengthen the universities for optimal service delivery. Objectives of the bill. The bill seeks to, one, amend the Federal Universities of Technology Act, CAP F23, Laws of the Federation 2004, to expand the scope of their curriculum to accommodate teaching of management technology and entrepreneurship and address emerging socio-economic challenges in Nigeria. Two, to expand the scope of funding for the universities through the establishment of a special fund to be administered by the Federal Ministry of Science and Technology to support conduct of research and innovation. And lastly, to strengthen the universities towards effective discharge of their statutory mandate. Conclusion, Mr. President, my highly respected distinguished colleagues, I have considered it expedient to solicit your support for the expeditious passage of this bill into law. I thank you immensely for your kind attention. Thank you, sir.
Senator Sanu, sir.
Thank you, Mr. President. My name is Muhammad Sani Musa, representing Niger East Electoral District. I stand to also support this bill for the passage because there is no way we can get out of the economic and security dilemma that we are in this country without seriously embracing technology. And so doing, our institutions must be expanded too, to be diversified to cover other areas that we lacked those manpower, especially when you're talking about science and technology, where it's just limited to certain curriculums or certain kind of professions. In a country where there are so many people with so many talents, but lacking to get admission, especially like in Federal University of Technology, MENA, where you see quite a number of our youths seeking admission and they cannot get the admission because they are not able to meet certain criteria of the courses that that university do. So in so doing, I believe that this bill is very important at this moment so that the curriculum of these universities will be expanded. And those courses that we need, those areas that we need to close up those gaps are now introduced to these universities. And in so doing, so many of our youths will get the admission, so many of our youths will be trained and qualified to at least cover those gaps, those areas that we have gaps in, especially in agriculture, even in the economy, because economy today also requires technology, because I just spoke about IT in my last contribution. So I support this bill, and I believe that my colleagues will also do the same. Thank you, Mr. President.
Those who feel that this will be now read a second time, say aye. Those against, say nay. Aye, sir. Clerk of the Senate.
Mr. President, distinguished senators, a bill for an act to amend the Federal Universities of Technology Act, CAP F23, Laws of the Federation of Nigeria 2004, and for other matters connected there with 2022. Second reading.
A bill for an act to amend the Federal Universities of Technology Act, CAP F23, Laws of the Federation of Nigeria 2004, and for other matters connected there with 2022. Second reading taken, and the bill is referred to the committee. Clause 73, protection of persons and witnesses. Clause 74. Clause 75. Clause 76. Clause 78, disclosure of assets and property by an arrested person on page 66. Clause 79, seizure of fund or property. And clause 80 on page 68, order of the court relating to seized property. Stand part of the bill, say aye. Those against, say nay, the ayes. Clause 81, freezing order on banks or other financial institutions, on page 70. Those in favor at clause 81, clause 82, clause 83, clause 84, obligation to report suspicious transactions, clause 85, clause 86, on page 75, clause 87, evidence pursuant to a request, clause 88, clause 89, and clause 90, on page 79. Stand part of the bill, say aye. Those against, any the ayes. Clause 91, Special Victims Trust Fund, Establishment Victims Trust Fund, on page 80. Those were at clause 91. Clause 92, Establishment of the Special Victims Trust Fund Committee. Clause 93. Clause 94. Clause 95. Clause 96. Clause 97 and clause 98. Stand part of the bill, say aye. Those against, say nay, the ayes have it. Those in favor that the interpretation on page 87. Stand part of the bill, say aye. Those against, say nay, the ayes have it. Those in favor that the short title on page 105. Stands part of the bill, say aye. Those against, say nay, the ayes. Those who are at the schedules 1, 2, and 3, stand part of the bill, say aye. Those against, say nay, the ayes. Those who are at the explanatory memorandum on page 114, stand part of the bill, say aye. Those against, say nay, the ayes. Those who are at the long title on page 1, stands part of the bill, say aye. Those against, say nay, the ayes. Leader of the Senate.
Mr. President, I rise to move that the chair reports progress. So move.
The minority leader.
I rise to second the motion as every move.
Distinguished colleagues, those in favor of the motion that the Senate reverse the plenary for the chair to report progress, say aye. Those against, say nay, the ayes have it. The Senate in the Committee of the Whole considered the report of the Committee on Judiciary, Human Rights and Legal Matters on the Terrorism Prevention Act 2013, Amendment Bill 2022, and approved as follows. Long title as recommended, clause 1 to 98 as recommended, interpretation as recommended, short title as recommended, schedules 1, 2, and 3 as recommended, the explanatory memorandum as recommended. Is this a true reflection of what transpired in the Committee of the Whole? Thank you. Leader of the Senate.
The President, I rise to move that this bill be read the third time.
Minority Leader.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise to second the motion assembly move. I so second.
Thank you. Distinguished colleagues, those in favor of the motion that this bill be now read the third time, say aye. Those against, say nay. The ayes have it. Clerk of the Senate.
Mr. President,
distinguished senators, a bill for an act to amend the Terrorism Prevention Act 2013 and for other matters connected there to 2022. Third reading.
A bill for an act to amend the Terrorism Prevention Act 2013 and for other matters connected there to 2022. Third reading taken. And the bill is passed. Well, congratulations to the Senate for passing this this very, very important bill on terrorism. And it is our belief here in the Senate that this bill, by the time signed into an act by Mr. President, will enhance the efforts of this government in the fight against terrorism, kidnapping, and other associated and related vices. This is one bill, one piece of legislation that can turn around not only the security situation in Nigeria, but even the economic fortunes of our country. We have done so much as a government in terms of infrastructural development across the country, in all parts of this country. But because the security situation is not the kind of situation that we all want, this tend to overshadow most of these tremendous and remarkable and massive developments in our country. I believe that the executive will waste no time in signing this bill into law, and it is our hope that this additional piece of legislation will achieve the purpose for which it has been worked upon by the Senate and indeed the National Assembly, and for the reason that it will also be signed by Mr. President. But let me make it very clear here that the fight against any insecurity, whether it is kidnapping, terrorism, or whatsoever, is not the sole purpose or the sole role of a government. The contribution, the support by citizens is essential, because our security agencies need vital and critical information to fight against terrorism and kidnapping and other things that makes life difficult for us. And the security agencies, we believe, are trying their best, but they need to do more. They need to achieve better. And any information is vital, and the security agencies must use information given to them, whether by citizens or by sister security agencies. With this, once again, I want to congratulate the Senate for this very important piece of legislation, once again, in support of a very important problem that bedevils our country. Leader of the Senate.
Sir President, my highly respected and distinguished colleagues, the seventh order of the day is a motion. Standing in the name of our distinguished Senator Biobara Kuma Deji Eremiyo, on the need to establish the National Museum at the Akasa Slave Trade Center in Bayelsa State to preserve national heritage. Mr. President, you may wish to invite distinguished Senator Deji Eremiyo Biobara Kuma to move the motion.
Very distinguished Senator Deji Eremiyo Biobara Kuma, Bayelsa East.
Thank you, Mr. President, for the very proficient way and manner you always pronounce my native names. Mr. President, I am Senator Deji Eremiyo. I represent Bayelsa East Senatorial District. This is a motion on the need to establish National Museum at the Akasa Slave Trade Center in Bayelsa State to preserve national heritage. The Senate notes that Akasa is a settlement at the southernmost tip of Nigeria in Bayelsa State, where the non-river estuary meets the Atlantic Ocean, with a lighthouse of 90 meters high navigational facility that had stood since 1910. Further notes that due to the proximity of Akasa to the Atlantic, the settlement has always been a traditional trading site in Nigeria, especially in the business of palm oil trade during the colonial era. Senate notes again that before the abolition of the slave trade, it was one of the major centers in the country where the harrowing effects of transatlantic slave trade resonates till this day. And during the British colonial years, it was the site of an outpost of the Royal Niger Company. Recalls that the Akasa settlement in the 17th century, now a sprouting town, was where the Nembe people in today's Bayelsa State waged a war valiantly against the British in 1895 with 22 war canoes and 1,500 foot soldiers due to the high-handedness of the Royal Niger Company and the obnoxious taxes imposed on the local people by the company. Senate notes interestingly that in the year 1899, the charter of the Royal Niger Company was revoked, and an act seen as partly a consequence of the war, with the effect that from 1st January 1900, the company sold all its possessions and concessions in Africa to the British government for £865,000. Senate is aware that some of the relics of the slave trade, such as slave house, slave masters, administrative block, and quarter, slave jetty, slave transit tunnel, white men graveyard, and what have you, can still be found, even though erosion of past decades had eroded some of the antiquities. And Senate observes that with the current efforts made by the government to diversify our economy, the Akasa town is a veritable historical heritage center which will boost our tourism potentials and consequently earn us foreign exchange if its heritage is well preserved. Senate accordingly resolves to urge the National Commission for Museum and Monuments to recognize the Akasa Slave Trade Center and establish it as a national slave trade museum in Bayelsa State. Mr. President, my distinguished colleagues, I thank you for this privilege.
Distinguished Senator Sadiq Suleiman Umar, Kwara North.
Thank you, Mr. President, my distinguished colleagues. I am Sadiq Suleiman Umar. I represent the good and decent people of Kwara North, and we all are. Mr. President, my distinguished colleagues, I rise to second the motion that there is need to establish National Museum at the Akasa Slave Center in Bayelsa State to preserve national heritage. Mr. President, my distinguished colleagues, like the mover of the motion rightly said, we've been paying lip service to diversification of our economies, and this is one of the greatest opportunities we do have to attract tourists, to bring in hard dollars to our country. Mr. President, I do know that there are small countries around the world, including African countries, where simple monuments, simple historical sites attract foreigners all over the world to come and observe. We have wonderful places in Nigeria, and this is just one of them. I therefore urge us all, Mr. President, my distinguished colleagues, to support this motion so that we can make sure we have this site a place for foreigners to come and observe the beauty and what we have in our country. Thank you, Mr. President.
Distinguished colleagues, let's go to the prayers. And there is only one prayer. Direct the National Commission for Museum and Monuments to recognize the Akasa Slave Trade Center and establish it as a National Slave Trade Museum in Bielsa State. Those in favor of this prayer say aye. Those against say nay, the ayes have it. Leader of the Senate, please stand down the other items. Yeah.
Mr. President, my highly respected and distinguished colleagues, given the exigencies of time having come this far and the fact that we have already come close to our 33 time of closure, I rise to move that we step down consideration of all other outstanding items on this agenda to another legislative day. So move.
Minority Leader.
Mr. President, distinguished colleagues, I rise to second the motion ably moved by the Senate Leader. I so second.
Thank you. Distinguished colleagues, those in favor of the motion moved by the Leader, seconded by the Minority Leader, that we stand down the consideration on the remaining items on the order paper till another legislative day, say aye. Those against say nay, the ayes have. Leader of the Senate, adjournment.
Sir President, I rise, move that this Senate do adjourn for our cellular break until the day of 10th May, Tuesday 10th May 2022 at 10 a.m. prompt. I so move.
Distinguished colleagues, we are adjourning for our cellular break, but in between the May Day will also be celebrated, the Labor Day, 1st May, and it's our opportunity here as a Senate to congratulate the Nigerian Labor Congress and TUC and other associated bodies, and indeed all workers of Nigeria, for standing to work hard for the development of our country, but we are asking them to do more and better. As a government, we will continue, as an institution, as a Senate, as a National Assembly or Parliament, we will continue to support our workforce. Our manpower is of immense importance to us in our development, and therefore we will continue to be very mindful, very supportive of our workers across the country. But to whom much is given, much will be expected. And this is a partnership between each and every one of us in this country. We play our different but very important roles in building our country. With this, I will put the question that those in favor of adjournment till the 10th of May, and that will be the Tuesday, 2022 at 10 a.m. prompt for us to celebrate with our families and other Nigerians the Eid Day and the Nigerian and the Labor Day or Workers' Day, say aye. Those against say nay. The ayes have it. We also wish our colleagues who have picked their forms, either running for the presidency, for the governorship, or for the Senate or House of Representatives on the opposite side, the best of luck. The DSP is already right inside the truck. We wish the DSP the best of outing and very successful contest by the grace of God. This Senate, once again, is adjourned until the 10th day of May. That's a Tuesday, 2022 at 10 a.m. prompt. Thank you.